that's a little bit of a guff, but we don't have a problem with it. It's just that we all know where he's coming from. He's coming from God made. I have these promises, these things from God. A lot of things that you guys are quoting and ascribing to and applying to the principles that we're learning in this book came from guess who? we don't jump on each other. But here's what we're going to find out today is that we're going to hear principles, like the principles of electricity. In other words, the basics for electricity is this, a positive and a negative force. Positive and negative. They attract. Like boy and girl, they attract. Now it's kind of...
Yeah.
but in the law of the universe, opposites attract. So in order for me to get the basics of electricity into a fabulous appliance, be it my flat screen TV, my refrigerator, that anything that operates off electricity, I have to apply something to the principles to make it fabulous. Same thing about the Word of God. We're here the principles this morning, and then we have to apply faith to the promises to get the promises to work in our lives. So the Word of God is there. You call it a law, you call it a principle, you call it a promise, but you have to apply, put an application to it to get it to be a reality to you. As long as I know positive and negative forces attract all day long. I get a positive end here, negative end here, kaboom, magnetize and meet. But how can I turn that into a radio, an appliance, what have you? I have to know how to apply stuff to it to make it get to where I want, get my end result. That's what faith is all, that's what we teach, that's what we try and teach. Okay, so here we go. Pick it up by Abraham. Where's my book? Oh, it's right in front of me. It says Genesis 11, but if you really want to know something about Genesis 12, you got to start with Genesis 11. Genesis 12 will have a lot of gaps in it. So Genesis 11, and I'm going to start with verse, see if I start with verse 14, we got a lot of reading and begatting and begatting and begatting. And verse 25, 24, let's start with all this begatting. Who is a, let's see here, sixth grade reader at least? At least. Okay, someone take that up all the way through verse 32 if you can. Verse 24 to 32, I challenge. Want me to give it a shot? Nahor lived 9 and 20 years and begat Terah. Underlying Terah, he's an important figure here. If you will, I'll put a star right now. And Nahor lived after he begat Terah 119 years and begat sons and daughters. Terah lived 70 years and begat who?
Abraham.
These are the Nahor and Haran are Abraham's two brothers, and Terah is the father. Now, verse 27. Now, these are the generations of Terah. Terah begat Abram, Nahor, and Haran begat Lot. So Lot's father was named Haran, and Haran died before his father. And really, translation is Haran died in the presence of his father in the land of his nativity in Ur of the Chaldeans, somewhere over there by Turkey, close to Syria. And Abraham and Nahor took them wives. The name of Abraham's wife was Sarah, and the name of Nahor's wife was Milcah, the daughter of Haran, the father of Milcah, and the father of Iscah. But Sarah was barren, she had no child. It looked like they might have married cousins or something. And Terah took Abram, his son, and Lot, the son of Haran, his son's son, and Sarah, his daughter-in-law, and his son Abram's wife, and they went forth with them from Ur of the Chaldees unto the land of Canaan, and they came unto Haran and dwelt there. Verse 31 appears as though they picked up Lot, because Lot, how they felt responsible for Lot, Abraham was uncle to you because of dad who died, and come on and come with us. Come on and come with us. And they came into Haran and dwelt there. And the days of Terah were 205 years, and Terah died in Haran. So Abraham's father lived to be 205 years old. And there was something that it's of note about this man, is that he had the crafty skills to build idols, to craft idols. And he that was his enterprise, kind of like over there in the book of Acts, where who was that was so good at all that crafty stuff and building idols. That's what Terah was involved with. He made his living that way. There is a story, scholar story, that Abram refused to pay much attention to these crafty idols that his father was making. And one day his father went on a journey and left Abram in charge of the shop. And Abram crushed all the false idols except for one. When his father returned, he said, what's wrong? What happened? He says, that God killed all your idols. So Abraham and his dad never did quite click as far as the occupation that his dad was involved in. Abraham always thought there was something more. And there was that kind of conflict. And they're on these journeys going through Ur of the Chaldees and into the land of Canaan. This is where they travel. And they're traveling to sell the merchandise and deal with the merchandise that's going on. That's why these guys are in the traveling mood. They're going through the land, pushing these false idols and selling them. And so never did sit well with Abraham. And if you ever kind of had a wonder as to why did God call Abraham, well, we know that God looks for, Christ has been preaching, the eye that his eye runs to and fro, looking for that heart that's what? Perfect. So here was a heart, Abram, his heart was more set toward trying to seek out the living God. First, that's why we come into chapter 12. It's not a division, time out, hold up. It keeps right on running. Chapter 12, verse, now, in light of all of this, that's what that now is saying. Now the Lord had said unto who?
Abram.
How did he say that to Abram? Anybody got any idea? How did Abram, what was Abraham's first encounter with the Lord like? The true and living God. I guess all we can go by is what. Well, how was Moses' first encounter?
Probably was frightening.
Frightening.
Yeah, I imagine.
And we have all kinds of recordings that God appeared like a burning bush, just appear any kind of way. And we do know that Abraham was not filled with the Holy Ghost, so it was not from his what? Gut. Could we say that? It wasn't from his gut intuition, subconscious. He got some kind of visitation from the Lord. And this is what God told him. What did he say there? That's part of our lesson. It's Genesis 12 and 1. Someone help me out, please.
Now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country, and from thy kindred, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee.
Has anyone ever wondered, before you even got into death, that's why would God tell a man to leave his father and his mother and just go on to a journey? Anybody ever thought about that when you first heard that story?
I did.
Yeah. Why would God just say to leave your family and go do his work?
Yeah. Interruption. And when he called him, if he were going to use him, mm-hmm. which he did, mm-hmm. then he could not do it within that environment because that environment was corrupt.
Okay.
So he had to separate him.
Okay. So this is what we call separating.
Yeah. When I first read that support, God was testing Abraham's love for his father. This is some years ago when I first got for his family. You know, I didn't know that Terrell was all, T-Rod was involved with all of this idolatry and all this kind of stuff. Just go leave the house and go do. Some folks say the Lord told me to leave family. No, it's a, there's a reason why God tell you to.
But it also was a test of his love. Yes. Well. That's yeah. Yeah.
You think that was the main test?
I don't think it was the main test.
No, but
it was a test, though.
It was, I guess he needs to separate from the folks that God could deal with it, like in one-on-one. Like, around his family, you know, there was a lot of distractions. It was keeping him, you know, from hearing what God had to tell him.
I think he was separating for his own good.
So when God tells us to separate and come out from among them, it's not to see if you love them or not. You still like Uncle Bob and all like that. No, it's just that they, that's a bad environment for you to be in. So, and all that unbelief and so forth, God couldn't work with him there in that, no kind of way. So he told Abraham, get thee out of thy country. And get out of that country and from your father's, and from thy kin, and from thy father's house, unto a land that I will show thee. All right, now, okay, God initiates the conversation, and he brings promises with the conversation. Those are the principles. Now we got to put application to it. All right, here we go. Now, verse 2. I will make of thee a, what kind of a nation?
Great nation.
Okay, three promises in verse 2. Someone help, point them out.
Great nation, a blessing, and it will be a blessing.
A great name. He'll make you, make you a great nation, a great name, and thou shalt be a blessing. Thou shalt be a blessing. So those were the promises. Now Abraham, because there was something, inclination going on with Abraham, that he's working with God, and he can determine what's right, what's wrong. There's something like that going on in Genesis 2:17, when God had his first man. That's just like verse 17. This is what's working in the life of mankind. But of the tree of knowledge of good and evil, thou shalt not eat of. Now, so man has now gotten to the point where he knows what's good and what's evil. That's one way God can talk with Abraham. And just for your FYI, Genesis chapter 10 is talking about that Tower of Babel. And, you know, man is a progressive. He's going to figure out stuff. And God is trying to show man that if you work with me, I can show you what's good and what's right, and you can progress. So here God has chosen his man who has determined this is good, what's good. Verse 2, I will make of thee the three promises, a great nation, a great name, and thou shalt be a blessing. That's Abraham, does he have anything tangible to hang that promise on?
Nothing.
So that's nothing.
That means he hadn't seen the land, don't know where it is. Nothing.
All right. Now, verse 3, can this promise be fulfilled in Abraham's day? The promise of verse 3. Someone read it out loud.
God blessed the seventh. Well,
verse 3.
I'm still in Genesis.
Okay, verse
3. The first book. Okay, and I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curseth thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed.
Okay. Question. Can that be fulfilled in Abram's day?
Yeah.
Huh?
Not totally fulfilled. No, because
it had,
that blessing had come
through
Jesus Christ.
So can that promise be fulfilled in Abraham's day?
Part of it can be fulfilled, but not the fullness of it.
As far as Abraham receiving it, he could say, yeah, I'm going for it. Okay, I'm going for it. But he didn't know that that promise could not be actually fulfilled in his day. So, to us Gentiles, Let us always understand that some of the things that God promised to Old Testament patriarchs and so forth, some of the stuff they could get, some of the stuff they could not get of those promises. And of this promise, Abraham could get only some of it because there was something else that was more to be done in God's sovereign work for it to come about. Yes?
Some of the blessings were not made manifest until about 400 years later.
Now Abraham, let's see what he did see. Make of thee a great nation. Could he see that in his day? A great nation?
No, because he didn't.
No. Promises full off. And make thy name great. How about make thy name great?
He had great wealth, but really.
We're going to see. Make thy name great, and thou shalt be a blessing. Abraham's day. All right. Here's one of the reasons why Sister Hill was referring to. It's Genesis 3:16. This is why some of this stuff could not be fulfilled. Study to show thyself. So let's see here. 3:16. Okay. What did he say? To the woman, he said, I would greatly multiply thy sorrow and thy conception. In sorrow thou shalt bring forth. Verse 15. Genesis 3, 15. I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and between thy seed and her seed. It shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel. Okay, what's going on there? Now, when God said that to the man and to the woman, guess who else was listening in? And remember, in the New Testament, Paul says, if the devil had known what that meant, he would never would have allowed the Lord to go to the cross. But the devil ain't the only one who don't know what that means. A lot of folks don't know what that means because they don't really check out the scriptures and follow the reality of redemption. And what God was saying is that, verse 15, I will put enmity between thee and the woman, and he's talking to the devil, and between thy seed and her seed was the clue. Her seed, woman don't have a seed, but her seed is going to bruise your head, Mr. Devil. And you're going to hurt his foot. He's going to kick you in the head so hard. Devil didn't get that. And then God came over there and met this man Abraham, running to and fro, saw this guy Abraham, and God made a promise to him in verse 3, get thee up, and in thee all families of the earth shall be blessed. In thee, all families of the earth shall be blessed. So how can we as Gentiles be blessed? It's because her seed came in and did the redemptive work that got us in line to be adopted. Okay, Hebrews 11:11, right quick, if you would just want to do some Bible referencing right quick. 11:11, Hebrews 11:11. There's a lot to cover here. I'm going to start flying in here. Hebrews 11:11. What about the Okay, and so here is her seed. Well, it's not her seed, but here is lining up for her seed to come through. Through faith also Sarah herself conceived strength to conceive seed, and was delivered of a child when she was past age, because she judged him faithful who had promised. So, we have the promise, and without apply faith, the promise is no good. So Abraham and Sarah had to be like husband and wife, and that's where it says Sarah received strength to get pregnant. Hello. That's what it said. This is no floop, floop, flop, flop. This is, she received, you know, she received strength to conceive and was delivered of a child when she was what? Past that age. Okay. All right. Because she judged him faithful. So you got to put some applied faith. Action. Yeah. Hallelujah. So folks, is, I believe in that. I believe in this. I believe God said. And I look and for some tracks, for some action. It's just a promise. It's no good until you put some action to it. That's called applied faith. Everybody still here or should we go over 10 minutes? Okay. All right. Here we go. Here we go. Right back to our lesson. All right. So this is how all the other people are going to get blessed. The origin of the promise. Genesis 12 is the introduction to the Abrahamic covenant. Abraham was three sons. Was one of three sons. They traveled through the land Mesopotamia, and now we're going to get into their travel. Verse 4, Abraham departed as the Lord had spoken unto him, and he took Lot with him. And Abram was 75 years old when he departed out of Haran. Now, here we go. We started off with Abraham journeying with his father. Now he comes into the land of Haran as a young man, and when he decides to leave out and follow God, he's an old man, 75 years old. He hung around for a long time. Now, let's see about this Abraham hanging around for a long time. Do you think in verse 4, between verse 3, verse 4, and all that activity, that Abraham might have gotten rich? And if you think he got rich, how do you think he got rich? What was his enterprise? Yeah. I would say he was in the same business, or maybe he inherited the business, the will of his father. His father died. So the business assets probably passed on to guess who? I mean, if your old crooked gambling Uncle Travis died and left you $1 million from his Osage Casino winnings, would you light up as a descendant of Brother Travis? You expect them to line up with you, with your Travis? Yeah, yeah, they'll be in line.
Sure would.
Yeah, I might not agree with his business, but hey, he's gone and look what he left.
Yeah, they might have talked about him while I was alive.
Yeah. You think Abraham might have learned some business skills, how to deal and negotiate and so forth, how to set the margins and the profits? He knows how to will and deal. So that's Abraham was traveling with his old man, lived around with his old man for a long time, and now he's got old, and it's time to get up and get out of your father's house, get away from the, dad is dead, it's cold dead. He's got a will. Hold on, let me get the portions of my will that's derived from me, and I'm gone, I'm out of here. That's my story, and I'm sticking to it. So Abraham came into his first little bit of money. So, time to go. What did he do in verse 5?
And Abram took Sarai, his wife, and Lot, his brother's son.
He's still beholding to Lot because my brother died and I got his son. I'm taking my brother's son with me.
And all their substance they had gathered, and the souls they had gotten in the land. And they went forth to go into the land of Canaan, and into the land of Canaan they came.
All right, so you see his accumulation. All their substance that they had, what? Gathered up. He made some stuff, made some money, increase. He knows about increase. And the souls means servants. Wonder how Haggai got in there. Servants, Sarah even picked up some servants. Haggai. And servants, now here's a deal that we should not overlook right quick. Abraham converted these folks to his living God. They were from Mesopotamia, they were from Turkey, Syria, and all these other outside non-Jewish nations. But Abraham, the servants that he brought into his house, he converted them to his belief system. Wow. He converted them. That they had gotten in Haran through the selling trade. And they went forth to go into the land. Now we're going into a deeper part of idolatrous land called Canaan. And the only reason why we're going into that land is that God had what? Promised it to them. Now, it's not heavily populated, but wherever he goes, he's seeing idolatry. That's the market of the day. Idolatry. Selling weed, selling drugs. Whoops. Met boys with boys, girls with girls. Lot, don't go over there. Stay over here with us. Don't get involved with all that. That's what they're looking at. That's what they're doing. We believe in the right way, the true and living God way. Like I've been teaching and telling you. You say, well, no, they didn't teach that. No, the Bible said Moses preached until the day that the flood came. Preached what? Righteousness. The patriarchs preached righteousness until the flood came. Trying to convert folks. Abraham doing the same thing. All those that came over with him in his household, became part of his household, he converted. He didn't have no idol worship in his house.
Like
his
soul
family
business before he did it.
I think what was inherited to him, he sold off and made money, and I'm out of here. You stupid enough to buy it? Here we go. It cost you $1,000 for that old famous. You like that one. Yeah, $1,000. We're out of here. So that's how he started making his money. His old man is dead, thank goodness. I'm selling this stuff and I'm out of here. All right, now I'm going into the land that God had promised me. It's more land, Canaan land. Is that too much land for one man? Yeah. Abraham would never need that much ground, ever. So it's enough ground for, too much for one man, but enough for a nation. And that's how Abraham looked at that promise. Look at all this land, man, I can't even want to get to any of it. I never will, I'm an old man. So the promises of God in your life, if he tells you you're an old man, I'll still promise you wealth, happiness, and all these great things. And you say, but Lord, I'm old, what can I do? What can I do? How can I enjoy a kid at 75, 45, 55, 65? Oh, guess what? It's not all for you. Starting to get healthy at an old age, it's not all for who? You. Starting to get rich at an old age, it's not all for who? You. Most of Abraham's blessings is for the people down the line. Start up the music lights. I want that dance floor in to me. Glory to God. So that's, when I see that promise, that's why Abraham didn't get overwhelmed. too much for me, but it's enough for a nation. That's what he's believing in. And into the land of Canaan, they came. All right, we still, y'all still with me?
Yes, here.
Okay, quick question. Did God, did Abraham leave his native land? Why did Abraham leave his native land? Was it because he was tired of his dad? No. It was because God told him to get up and go. Get up and go. And was it by revelation or was it by some type of visitation? Probably by some type of visitation. Okay, now the word blessed, because a lot of times we think it is saying that when God blessed Abraham, he blessed him with substance. But it's more than that. Here's what God blessed Abraham with. And he says, I will bless thee. It was which got protection, guidance, and his presence. Protection, guidance, and presence of the Lord. That's what Abraham received. Protection, guidance, and God's presence. Alright, let's go with verse 6. And Abram passed through the land until the place of Sichem? Until the land of Moreh. And the Canaanites was then in the land. Can you give me a description of what Abraham, the neighborhood of Abraham moved into? Kind of like, Sister Hill lives in a nice neighborhood. But there's a place not too far from Sister Hill's house. Denver, you know where the old Safeway store is down on Denver, Sister Hill? I think it's Tulsa County voting place now.
Oh, yeah.
Election center. Yeah. You know where that is right there?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. Just two blocks, well, not one street behind that. And when Candy was in high school, she would catch the bus on that street. Because she worked at home. But one, right behind the, right out the back door, there's a street, and you go two blocks to the north.
And it's a red light district.
No, it's not a red light district. Oh. It has these streamers hanging down from houses. Those are
you
markers.
Mean now?
Right there.
Oh, okay.
I think you can go there now and find some.
Uh-huh.
These streamers, about three or four on each house. But like we hang out the flower baskets, they kind of hang out these streamers. And there's about three or four houses down there. And guess what those mean? Don't tell me I don't know. That's a gay house.
What?
A gay. That's a gay couple.
Oh, no.
And that's a gay couple. That's a gay couple. Those are the symbols. If you ever watch TV and these gay people demonstrate like the New York Gay Pride Parade, they have these streamers.
Oh, you on TV?
Yeah, if you ever see them on TV. And then I was over there one day and I said, that's what that is. And you keep looking. That's what's going on.
With the rainbow
colors. Gay community.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Gay community.
No,
the
rainbow.
Yeah, purple and these crazy colors.
Yeah, the rainbow.
So what if they move next door to you? How will you feel? How would you feel?
They have stickers on their cars.
Yeah. Well, Travis, couple any vacant houses in your neighborhood? Couple of them, and all of a sudden now they got people living in them, and they got these streamers coming down, identification markers.
Streamers,
advertising. I invite you to go there one day. I think the name of that street might be called Cheyenne.
One block behind there is Cheyenne.
I think it's called Cheyenne. You can't miss it.
And they have
yeah. Streamers. So that's the neighborhood, and into the land of Canaan they came.
That's why years ago.
So I come to find out that gay people just don't think it's okay to be attracted to the opposite sex. They have some other religious